Hello, my name is Arnaud Delorme, and this is part one of a series of videos on time frequency analysis of EEG time series. This part is about Fourier analysis of the EEG signal. So let's first talk about the biophysics of the EEG signal. EEG was first discovered by Hansberger. In 1924, he defined the EEG alpha rhythm. Here is a neuron. On top are the dendrites. On the bottoms is the cell body. The dendrites integrate the electrical signal and transfer it to the cell body. And this movement of electrical charges along the dendrite generates an electrical potential. When we have many of these neurons oriented in the same way and active at the same time, these electric fields sum to generate what we call the local field potential, which is the EEG at the surface of the cortex. Through volume conduction, this potential may then be recorded at the EEG scalp sensors. So this is where the EEG comes from. It comes from synchronized cell excitation of large groups of neurons. And the synchrony of cell excitation determines the amplitude and rhythm of the EEG signal. So you may have heard of common oscillatory mode of the EEG signal. This is simulated ideal data, and these are sinusoids at different frequencies. We typically define the alpha EEG rhythm as rhythm from 9 to 11 hertz, and then beta from 18 to 21 hertz, gamma from 30 to 60 hertz. Then we have the lower frequencies with theta from 4 to 7 hertz and delta from 0.5 to 2 hertz. These are, of course, idealized signal. And when you look at the actual EEG signal, it would look more like this. And as you can see, for each frequency of interest, there is actually a mixture of different signals at different frequencies. So in real EEG, a given frequency is rarely seen in its pure form. So now we're going to see how we can extract the frequency content of the EEG signal. And for this, we need to make the assumption that the EEG signal is stationary. So this is not entirely true for EEG signal, but it's approximately true over short time windows. And by stationary, we mean that the first and second moment, so the mean and the variance of the data distribution, doesn't depend on time. So let's look at an example. Here we have different stationary sinusoids, one at 2 hertz, one at 10 hertz, one at 20 hertz. If we simply add the signal, as this is represented in the bottom right corner, you can see that this signal has complex feature. And it is stationary because it is a sum of stationary signal. Now, if we want to analyze this signal to see what the signal is made out of, we can perform a power spectrum. By looking at the power spectrum of the signal, we can recognize three frequency components of the signal at 2, 10, and 20 hertz. So in the next slides, we're going to see how to build such a power spectrum. So Fourier stated that any stationary continuous process can be exactly described by an infinite sum of sinusoids at different amplitude and phases. So let's first define what we mean by amplitude and phase of sinusoid. Here is a sinusoid, and the amplitude is the height on the y-axis, and the phase is the shift of the sinusoid on the x-axis. So here we have a signal in the time domain on your left, and a frequency decomposition of this signal on your right. We only have one frequency here, but we're going to add some more. So now we have three different frequencies with different phases and amplitude. And you can see that as we sum over these frequencies, the original time domain signal starts to appear. When we use more frequencies of different phases and amplitude, we can recover at the bottom right the original signal. We can then construct the power spectrum by just looking at the amplitude at different frequencies. So at this frequency, the amplitude is relatively high, so we have a peak in the power spectrum. At this other frequency, the amplitude is very low, so we have a trough in the power spectrum. And at this third frequency, the amplitude is high again, so we have another peak in the power spectrum. As a side note, the power spectrum is actually not the raw amplitude, but the square of the amplitude of all of these frequencies. So this is how the power spectrum is built. And the goal of Fourier analysis is to learn the correct amplitude and phases for each sinusoid such that their sum reconstruct the original time series. So a little bit formally, we already saw the amplitude and phase shift of a sinusoid. And this is the equation describing the sinusoid. When dealing with sinusoid, we usually use the angular frequency, which is equal to 2 pi times the frequency in hertz. And this cosine formula is equal to the real part of this complex exponential. This is Euler formula. And this complex number is called a phasor, sometimes represented by S of omega and time. So a phasor may be represented with a vector, and the length of the vector represents the amplitude, and the angle of the vector represents the phase. So you might have seen this other notation from Euler's formula in which a complex exponential can be decomposed into a real cosine part and an imaginary sine part. So let's see an example here. This is the phasor that we just talked about. And as time increases, we can see the phasor rotates. And this is the representation of the real part of phasor, which is the cosine. And here's another representation with three phasors, and the purple being the sum of the red and blue phasors. And we can see different phase and amplitude of this phasor as time increases. So let's go back to Fourier definition, which states that a signal in the time domain can be described by a sum of sinusoid with different amplitude and phases. So this is what this equation represents here for a single frequency. When we apply this formula for a given frequency, we obtain a phasor at that frequency, which has a specific amplitude and phase here in red. And the power reflects the covariance between the original signal and a complex sinusoid at that frequency. And of course, we also have the inverse Fourier transform in which we can take and combine these phasors across frequencies and get back the original time domain signal, as I showed you in one of the first slides. So this slide is to show you how this is calculated in MATLAB. This is a discrete Fourier transform function that takes a column time signal vector as input. We loop over frequency, and in the in loop, we apply the formula from the previous page by summing over time samples. So you can check it's the exact same formula. And not that for reference, we can actually do not need to do this in a loop. Using MATLAB vector notation, we can simply multiply a raw vector by a column vector and obtain exactly the same result. So this is a discrete Fourier transform. If you copy and paste this code to create a MATLAB function, give it an input array, and compare the output of this function with the MATLAB fast Fourier transform function, you will obtain exactly the same result. And by the way, the difference between the discrete Fourier transform and the fast Fourier transform is basically that the fast Fourier transform is faster. The fast Fourier transform uses some mathematical trick, so it can reuse some of the value calculated for some frequencies for other frequencies. So this is the end of this part, and I'll see you in the next video.